तो मॉड्यूल 12 हो कोशेंट स्पेसेस। द आइडिया ऑफ ए कोशेंट मैप एंड द कंस्ट्रक्शन ओपन द फ्लड गेट्स ऑफ ज्योमेट्रिक टोपोलॉजी टू अस। वी कैन नाउ स्टडी ए लार्ज क्लास ऑफ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग ज्योमेट्रिक ऑब्जेक्ट्स वाया टोपोलॉजी। Before proceeding with the topology, let me make it clear that all of you understand the meaning of a surjective map, surjective function from one set to another set. Okay, and what it means in terms of decomposition of X or equivalence classes. Okay, there are three different pictures of this, which imply the same thing, same concept. Look at this diagram. The first portion here represents a surjective function, a onto function from one set X to another set Y. When you have this, you can take F inverse of Y as Y ranges over capital Y, that will give you disjoint union of X, as I have written down here. F inverse of Y means all points of X which come to the point Y here. Okay, so by the very definition of F, they are disjoint. And the entire X is a union of these things. Because F is surjective, each F inverse of Y will be what? Non-empty. Therefore, what we get is a non-empty disjoint decomposition of X. Okay? So, such a thing is called a decomposition or a partition. So, what we have got here is a surjective function into another set implies a partition of X or a decomposition of X. Now suppose you have a partition of X, okay, then you can define an equivalence relation on the set X, namely in which the partition members will become equivalence classes. Namely, X is equivalent to Y if and only if it is in the same subset. In particular here, what will be the relation? X1 will be equal to X2 if and only if Fx1 is equal to Fx2. So a partition giving rise to a relation or a function directly giving a relation, this picture you can get from here directly or from here. Finally, suppose you have an equivalence relation like this on X. Look at the equivalence classes. That is a set. Call that set as Y. Then what should be the function from X to Y? Take any X and take its equivalence class. So from equivalence relation, you can come to a surjective function. If you follow this procedure again, this cycle, what you get is whatever you have started with. Namely, suppose you have an equivalence relation and then you have defined F to be X going to the equivalence class of X. Then what will be the disjoint union here? There will be equivalence classes. And what is the equivalence relation induced by that? The same equivalence relation, because these are the equivalence classes correspond to this relation. Okay. So this is what I am saying. Giving a surjective function on a set is equivalent to giving a partition by F inverse of Y. And then giving a partition, say X is disjoint union of AI, you can define X is equivalent to X2 if and only if both X1 and X2 are the same subset AI. So this is an equivalence relation. Finally, giving an equivalence relation, we can take y to be the set of equivalence classes and define f as f of x equal to the equivalence class of x. Okay. So verify that if you run the cycle of arguments again, what you get is wherever you started from, you come back to the same point, same concept. So when you have an equivalence relation or a surjective function or a decomposition, even if one of them is given, you should have all the three in your mind so that you can use them, whichever one, whichever description you want, you can use. Now let us come to the topology. Suppose X tau is a topological space, X is a set and tau is a topology, right? And Q is a surjective function from X to Y, where Y is any set. We want to make Y into a topological space such that Q becomes continuous. And this we want to do in an optimum way. Okay. Can we put, how many open sets can we put? As much as possible. That's the whole idea. So I define tau prime, which is going to be a topology on Y, as follows. Take a subset of Y. If Q inverse of that subset is inside tau, then put it here. That means a subset of B is belongs to tau prime if and only if Q inverse of B belongs to tau. This tau prime will be automatically a topology on Y. Very easy to check. Namely, Q inverse of intersection of two sets B1 and B2 is nothing but Q inverse of B1 intersection Q inverse of B2. So since tau is a topology, that intersection belongs to tau prime. Similarly, Q inverse of a collection BI, union of all BI, say arbitrary union, is nothing but Q inverse of BI and take the union. That will be inside tau because each BI is there, right? Q inverse of BIs are there. Therefore, union of BIs will be inside. All right, so tau prime is a topology. Automatically, Q is continuous. Why? Because take a set here in tau prime, its inverse image by very definition is in tau. So this topology does satisfy that Q is continuous. This topology is called the quotient topology, and the space Y with this topology is a quotient space. The map Q will be called quotient map. Some people call it identification space. Because surjective map, it may not be injective, identifies a certain number of points which are taken to the same point in Y. It's also called decomposition space using the second description that we have there. Every surjective function gives you a decomposition of the set or partition of the set. So those names are also used by some authors. Often, quotient map from X to Y and the quotient topology are described by one of the following two statements. So you should know various different definitions here. They could all be taken as definition of quotient space. The first one is U contained inside Y is open if and only if Q inverse U is open in X. The second condition is by taking a De Morgan law, F contained inside Y is closed if and only if Q inverse of F is closed in X. If and only if is important. Only if follows by Q continuity of Q. Okay, if this is there, will tell you that everything that whatever satisfies has been put. Okay, therefore, I get a third one which describes the quotient topology, namely this theorem, which says that quotient topology on Y is the largest topology with respect to which Q is continuous. If suppose some lambda is a topology on Y such that Q is continuous with respect to that topology. X topology hasn't changed, topology on X hasn't changed, okay? Then I want to say that every element of lambda, every open subset in this topology is in the quotient topology that we have defined, namely the tau prime. How? Take a certain, say, lambda, its inverse image is open in X because Q is continuous. But that is enough to put this one inside tau prime. Therefore, lambda is contained inside tau prime. Therefore, tau prime is the largest topology. Okay. One more criteria, so this will be the fourth one, which is called in some parlor as the universal property of the quotient map. So let us go through this one carefully. You start with a quotient map. Okay, now take any function, any continuous function from X to Z, which as a function factors down from Y to Z. Factoring down from Y to Z just means that there is an F tuple here such that you start with Q and then compose with this F tuple composite Q is equal to F. It's the same thing as saying that whenever F takes two points to the same point here, sorry, whenever Q takes two points of X to same point here, F must take the same points, same point to the same point here, these two points, same point here. F of x1 equal to f of x2, whenever q of x1 equal to q of x2. Then you get a map like this, function like this. Okay, this is a set theoretic fact. Okay, but what this theorem says is that this f tuple is automatically continuous. There is a unique continuous map. No matter what F is, what Z is, once they satisfy the set theoretic property correctly, to get a map, get a function like this, continuity of F will imply continuity of F tuple. You see, continuity of F tuple automatically implies continuous of F because F is F hat composite Q. Composite of two continuous functions is continuous. Here, what this theorem says is that F is continuous and F hat is continuous. So this is the so-called universal property of Q because it is true for all F and all Z. And there is no other function, okay, which is continuous like this, which satisfy this one. Such maps are called quotient maps. You can take this as definition. Let's go through this one. Why this is so? Okay. Set theoretically, that condition will tell you there is an F tuple. Why F tuple is continuous is what you have to show. The continuity of F tuple follows. Start with an open subset in Z. Its inverse image must be open here. But what is the condition for a set to be open here? Its inverse image under Q must be open in X. So I have to take the open subset U here, F tuple inverse, then Q inverse. So that must be open in X. But F tuple inverse, Q inverse, nothing but F inverse, because F is nothing but Q composite, F12 composite Q. So if F is continuous, F inverse of U is open here, so we are done. The above theorem can also be taken as a definition of the quotient topology. If we have given a topology tau twiddle on Y, okay, suppose I have some other topology Y, and it satisfies this property, then tau twiddle will have to be tau prime. There's no other choice. That is the meaning of this. Okay, so I once again repeat. So such a property is called universal property. Here is an example. Quotient maps occur plenty in mathematics. For instance, take a surjective open map. It will be automatically a quotient map. Surjective, open, and continuous. Automatically, it's a quotient map. Why? Because take an open subset in Y, take any subset in Y, okay, its inverse image, I want to show its, suppose I want to show inverse image is open, then I want to show that U is open, but that follows because F of the inverse image of F under inverse image of U is U itself. Okay, F of F inverse U is U. F inverse U is open and F is open, therefore U is open. So this is the only part. F is continuous, so if U is open, F inverse U is open is easy because F is continuous. So openness gives you that it's a quotient map also. Exactly same way by taking De Morgan law, if you have a closed map, closed, continuous and surjection, that is also quotient. Okay. You may be under the impression that these are the only cases. No. Of course, quotient maps are much more general than open maps or closed maps. Okay. But open maps are plenty again, namely all coordinate projections from any product space into any factor. X cross Y to X cross Y to Y, R to R3, R4 to any of these coordinate spaces, they are all open maps, the projection maps. But be careful, projection maps are not closed. Okay, you may be knowing that the standard projection XY to X or XY to Y inside R2 to R is not a closed map. Just look at the image of the hyperbola XY equal to 1. By the very definition, XY equal to 1 is a closed set inside R2. Its image inside the x-axis, what is it? It is all the real numbers minus the 0. And that is not a closed set. Okay. So I will give you some examples of maps which are quotient maps, but they are neither open nor closed. Okay. So I have just cooked up this example. It's not very standard. It's not occurring naturally. There are such natural things also, of course. Okay, here, just for simplicity, in one single example, I have shown you a quotient map is neither open nor closed. So what I do? I take the whole of real line or some large interval. Okay, so let me take the whole of real line. Then look at the open interval 0, 1. All the points in 0, 1, you identify to a single point. 0, less than t, less than 1, all of them will be identified to a single point. Similarly, look at the closed interval 2, 3, all the points in between, namely 2 and 3 included, identify it to another single point. Different points, another single point. So these two are different points, not the same point. So these are all relation. Rest of the points are not identified with any other thing. Okay? Look at the space Y obtained and let Q from R to Y be the resulting quotient map. So Y is the quotient space. Then I want to say that this map Q is neither open nor closed. Okay, why it is not open? The open interval 2, 3, the image of that Q of 2, 3 is equal to what single point? Namely Q of closed interval 2, 3. Closed interval 2, 3 and open interval 2, 3 are the same image point. That point is not an open set. Why? Because this inverse image is the closed interval 2, 3, which is not open inside R. Okay. So therefore, Q of open interval 2, 3 is not open. That means Q is not a open mapping. Okay, it is not a closed mapping. You come to the first part. Take any point in 0, 1, any single point. It's a closed set in R. But the image, which is the same thing as image of open interval 0, 1, one single point. Open interval 0, 1, one single point, Q of that is same thing as Q of 1 by 2. Right? That point is not a closed point because its inverse image is the open interval 0, 1, which is not a closed subset of R. So this map is neither closed nor open. So here is a picturesque representation of what I have done. This is the open interval 0 to 1 and this is 2 to 3. Closed interval. This entire closed interval is going to a single point. Here the open interval is coming to this red point, but the end points of this interval, they have come just nearer to that one. Why is, what is the meaning of nearer? If you take the closure of this red point in the quotient topology, that will contain both the end points. Okay. So in particular, the red point, singleton red point, is not a closed set. Okay, so that way that you can just go up. If you open the subset, its closure is this entire 0, 1, 0 and 1. Okay, in particular, the quotient space is not a T1 space because this image of 0 here, image of 1 here, cannot be separated by open sets. Image of this open interval, this red point, if you take any neighborhood of the red point, it will contain both of them. So it is not T1 space. The singleton 0 is not open is enough to say that it's not T1 space. Okay. Finally, here is an example. While discussing loops, we have used the fact that the space obtained by identifying the endpoints of the closed interval 0, 1 is homeomorphic to S1. So let us write down a neat proof of this one, right? By taking the exponential function on the interval 0, 1, q theta equal to e raised to 2 pi I theta. Then what happens? Q of 0 and Q of 1 go to the same point and no other point is identified with any different point. In other words, Q is injective on the open interval 0, 1, right? Therefore, if you look at the inverse image of a point in Q, only the inverse image of one contains two distinct points. All other things are singletons. So this is the same thing as saying that the identification set as a set is it is S1. Right? 0, 1, 0 and 1 are in the same equivalence class, and rest of them are in different equivalence class. That is the meaning of that what we have done by identifying 0 and 1 in the interval, close interval 0, 1. So set theoretically we are fine. So what we have to verify is the subspace topology of S1 coming from R2 is the quotient topology on S1 coming from I via this map Q. This is what we have to verify. In other words, Q is a continuous function, it's fine, because we know that exponential function is continuous. It is surjective also fine. What we want to say is Q itself is a quotient map. If we know Q is a quotient map, then our justification, our claim that identifying 0 and 1 inside the closed interval 0, 1 to a single point, whatever space you get is homeomorphic to S1. So what we have observed is now we have to verify that this exponential function is a quotient map. So we know that this can be done if we verify that this is a closed map, because we have observed that closed maps are quotient maps. Okay. So that can be done very easily. Take any subset K of I which is closed. K itself is a bounded set because I is bounded. Bounded and closed subset of a Euclidean space in R, it's a compact space. K being compact, the image of K under a continuous function Q, 2K must be compact. A compact subset of a metric space, S1, a standard topology, so it must be closed subset. So FK is closed, QK is closed. So closed set goes to closed set means the function Q is closed. And that is the end of this argument here. Okay. So we will study more of quotient spaces next time. Thank you.